All right, guys, this is one of the most critically important topics I've ever covered. I've talked about a lot of things on this channel that are associated with aging, but in my honest opinion, nothing has a bigger impact and is more insidious than loss of mobility. I strongly suggest you guys watch this video. There are a lot of things that can cause you to age, like all the hallmarks of aging, like sarcopenia or loss of erectile function or a hormone imbalance. But there's nothing that will have as big an impact as a loss of mobility. Of all the biomarkers that can define how old someone is, either biologically or functionally, nothing says old like loss of mobility. You see some old guy shuffling along, taking tiny steps, bent over, afraid that he'll fall. 90% of what you're looking at is loss of mobility. A loss of mobility can cause a cascade of other factors that are all indicators of advanced age. Retaining a full range of motion, preserving a high degree of mobility, can not only indicate a functionally young biological age, but it can also keep a lot of other biomarkers of aging at bay. But here's the thing. Of all the biomarkers, loss of mobility is the most insidious. Once we reach 50 or 60, most of us have sustained a significant loss of mobility and don't even know it. Very few of us have glommed on to the fact that our mobility is in rapid decline, and we need to change that. Okay, let's start off by defining what mobility is so that we're all on the same page. Now, here's my favorite definition. Mobility is the ability of a joint to move through its full range of motion with control before being restricted. This definition speaks to flexibility, joint health, strength, and range of motion, all components of mobility. Now, for a long time, the terms mobility and flexibility have been used interchangeably. They've meant pretty much the same thing. But realistically, the term mobility is an umbrella term that encompasses a lot of factors, and flexibility is just one of them. Flexibility is the ability of any soft tissue, such as a muscle, a tendon, or a ligament, to temporarily elongate, to stretch like a rubber band. And that's all it is, really. It's just about impossible to have a high degree of mobility without flexibility. But just because you're flexible doesn't guarantee a lot of mobility. There's several other factors that could still prevent a high degree of mobility. Like strength. Flexibility is passive, meaning that the ability of tissue to elongate is something that happens regardless of whether you're driving that elongation or someone else is driving it, like a physical therapist. But mobility is active. It's you driving the movement through the entire range of motion. And how much strength there is in the muscle that drives that motion can definitely affect the movement. So can joint health. If the joint isn't healthy, if the cartilage has lost collagen and starts to deteriorate, if there's not enough synovial fluid or lubrication, if the ligaments have lost elasticity, then the joint's not going to move through its full range of motion. And if you're injured, pain is going to hinder or prevent movement. But there's something else that can restrict your mobility that most people don't even think about, and that's the nervous system, the brain-muscle connection. When you move, that movement depends on neuromuscular coordination of movement patterns. All the tiny commands that go to all the muscles that are activated with that movement. Not only which muscles are activated to achieve that movement, but also how much each one gets activated. All those commands that your brain sends to all those muscles without you even thinking about it. Those are neuromuscular coordination of movement patterns. Now, as you age, or if you get injured, these patterns can get rewritten. If you injure a muscle, for example, and it isn't as strong or it hurts too much to contribute as much as it once did to a movement, then helper muscles are recruited. These are muscles that normally stabilize a joint rather than power the joint through its range of motion. And as powerful primary muscles get recruited less due to an injury and helper muscles get recruited more, new patterns get written. Once the primary muscle is healed, that new pattern can remain. And this can cause a loss of mobility. This is one of the primary causes of a change in a person's gait as they grow older. So mobility is determined by how flexible a person is, by how much strength the muscles possess, by how healthy the joints are, by the range of motion that a joint has, by whether or not soft tissue has sustained an injury, and by neuromuscular coordination of movement patterns. And it can be lost by a loss of muscle mass known as sarcopenia, a loss of bone mass known as osteoporosis, and by a reduction in range of motion, which can in turn be caused by loss of flexibility, declining joint health, injuries, and faulty neuromuscular patterns. Okay, next, we're going to briefly cover what causes a loss of mobility as we age. And it's a multitude of different things. And for most of us, not just one or two, but all of them. All of these causes are very common things that most of us are suffering from. First, let's talk about sarcopenia and osteoporosis. Sarcopenia is the age-related loss of muscle mass, and osteoporosis is the age-related loss of bone mass. When you lose muscle mass, you become weaker. And if your weaker muscles don't have the strength to pull a joint through its full range of motion, you lose mobility. Loss of bone mass can lead to frailty, and both are significant risk factors for loss of mobility. A loss of flexibility in the muscles or the connective tissue or declining joint health can also lead to a decline in range of motion. But here's a big one, restricted tissue. Now, it's pretty common for small micro tears to occur in the muscle tissue, especially if you're lifting weights. Now, that's one of the driving forces in hypertrophy, the building of new muscle. But sometimes we sustain an injury to the muscle tissue and a larger, more localized tear can occur. And you'd be surprised how many different things can cause an injury. A training injury, sure, but also poor posture, sleeping wrong. How many of us have gone to sleep feeling just fine and then have awakened with what amounts to a sports injury? When this happens, scar tissue forms to provide a support matrix as part of the natural healing process. But this scar tissue can remain after the healing is finished. And now you've got what's called an adhesion. And adhesions can grow and become more severe. The muscle fibers can become stuck together, restricting movement, causing pain and weakness, and causing a loss of mobility. It can then begin to impact the surrounding tissue, causing further pain and dysfunction, and further loss of mobility. But it gets even worse. The injury can weaken the muscle, causing it to be recruited less when moving a joint. As it's recruited less, helper muscles, muscles that are there to support a joint through its full range of motion, not drive it, these helper muscles get recruited more. And eventually, you've rewritten neuromuscular coordination of movement patterns, which contributes to even more loss of mobility. And here's the thing. While aging can impact mobility, the loss of mobility can impact the aging process. It's a vicious cycle. Mobility is one of the key factors in determining how well one is aging. It's the litmus test of healthy aging and a strong prognosis of disability and survival. Maintaining mobility can make the difference between living at home and living in a facility. One of the first symptoms of advanced loss of mobility is a change in a person's gait, how they walk. A change in gait can increase the risk of falling and of breaking a bone, like a hip joint. Men face a 33% higher risk of death in the first year after breaking a hip. Now, I know a lot of you are thinking that you haven't lost that much mobility. You can still get around pretty easily. Well, here's a test that you can take right now to determine if that's true or not. You want to get on the floor with your legs crossed in front of you. And what you want to do is you simply want to lean forward and get up without using your hands. Now, the first time I tried to do this, as soon as I leaned forward, I knew I wasn't going to be able to do it. When I leaned forward, I couldn't get my weight off my butt, and I knew I wasn't going to be able to stand up. Now, I guarantee you that if you're like most people, when you were in your 20s, you could probably do this without even thinking about it. Now, one thing, when you lean forward, the best way to do it is to do it without using momentum. Just try to get up with control, do it slowly. Now, here's how you do it. You just simply roll forward and get up without using your hands. Now, if that's too difficult to do, try it this way. Again, get on the floor with your feet crossed in front of you. Roll forward onto your knees and get up without using your hands. And if you can't do that, here's a third method. lean forward with your hands in front of you, your legs crossed in front of you, and then roll back and roll forward using some momentum. Now, the best way to do this is don't use momentum at all. Do it with control. And yeah, that's how you do it. Now, here's one of the things about mobility. If you've lost it and you catch it early enough, it's not that hard to restore it. You want to know what one of the biggest risk factors for loss of mobility is? Reduced activity levels. As we get older, most of us move less and less. Here's some interesting statistics. 70% of us claim to hate sitting, yet 86% of us do it all day, every day. When we get up, more than half of us use getting something to eat as an excuse. We sit, on average, 13 hours a day. And if we sleep for 8 hours, that only leaves 3 hours for activities that don't involve sitting. If you want more mobility, be more mobile. Okay, earlier, I talked about several things that can cause a loss of mobility. Let's go through them one at a time. And first up is sarcopenia and osteoporosis. And the cure to both is nutrition and exercise. Lifting weights has been demonstrated in numerous clinical studies to reduce both the loss of muscle mass and the loss of bone mass, or even stop them in their tracks. So can consuming a healthy supply of things like protein, calcium, collagen, hyaluronic acid, and vitamins C, D3, and K2. Next, let's talk about range of motion. And let's tackle flexibility first. The best way to improve flexibility is with stretching. Now, we all know this, but a lot of us ignore it. I used to. It just seemed like too big an investment in time. But now it's part of my daily routine. And you know what I was surprised to discover? It's pretty easy to do, and it feels really good. Now, the first thing I want to say about stretching is that it shouldn't be painful. A little bit of pain is okay, but when a stretch starts to become really painful, that's a signal to stop. You'll get bigger gains by holding a less painful stretch for about 30 seconds than you will from blasting through a really painful stretch and possibly injuring yourself. Okay, there's several different types of stretching, and you need to do all of them, or most all. First, there's static stretching, or passive stretching. This involves stretching a muscle to its maximal elongated state and then holding that position for a given length of time, usually 30 to 60 seconds. And there's several different types of static stretching. The first is stretching a muscle through the power of your own muscles. It's just you, without any apparatus, going through your stretches. The second is where you stretch your muscles through the use of another person or a piece of apparatus. Now, in this type of stretching, you completely relax your muscles and let the other person or piece of apparatus do all the work. The piece of apparatus could be the floor, a wall, a towel, or a band or strap. This type of stretching usually produces better results than using your own muscles. The next two types are pretty similar, but work in opposite ways functionally. They're both basically a form of an isometric stretch. The first is called PNF stretching, or proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation, and it requires another person or a band or a strap. And it's one of the most effective forms of stretching. To perform a PNF stretch, you stretch a muscle, hold it in place, and then contract the muscle that would return it to its normal position without allowing any actual movement. You perform a PNF stretch several times, increasing the stretch or range of motion with each consecutive stretch. The other type of isometric stretch is called active isolated stretching. It's based on the concept that each joint has opposing sets of muscles that move it in opposite directions. And there's a circuit in the brain that prevents both sets from activating at the same time. So the idea is that by activating the set that you're not stretching, it deactivates the set that you are stretching. With that set deactivated, you should be able to get a bigger stretch. So you activate the opposite set of muscles that you activate in the PNF stretch. Okay, so we're going to move on to the other type of stretching, which is called dynamic or active stretching. Now, this is the type of stretching where you actively move through a range of motion, stretching out the muscle at the end of the movement, and you keep repeating this movement. These are also called mobility drills. These are the type of movements that are typically done as part of a warm-up prior to exercising. Now, there's a type of active stretching called ballistic stretching. And this is where you use gravity and momentum to get a bigger stretch. Usually, this involves bouncing. And this is a type of stretch that you want to avoid. Bouncing to get a bigger stretch can result in an injury. You always want to move through your range of motion on a stretch with control. That means that you move slow enough to stop before encountering a lot of pain and injuring yourself. Now, there's another type of exercise that I want to make you aware of called neuromuscular repatterning. I don't know much about it because it's usually done with the assistance of physical therapists who are trained in the science of neuromuscular repatterning. So if your body has rewritten neuromuscular coordination of movement patterns as a result of an injury, these are exercises that you can do to go in and rewrite those patterns back to where they're supposed to be. Now, I know that some of you are probably thinking, gee, Lance, that's great, but could you demonstrate some of these exercises? And you know what? I hear you, and that's just what I'm going to do. I'm preparing some videos for the future in which I will walk you through some of these exercises, so keep an eye out for them. Now, I want to talk about adhesions. As I mentioned, they can be a huge factor in loss of mobility, and there's something that you can absolutely do about them. I had a training injury about 3 years ago that just totally screwed up my shoulder. My range of motion was radically limited, and I couldn't move my arm at all without severe pain. I went to my doctor, I went to chiropractors, I went to physical therapists. After almost 2 years, I basically decided that it wasn't going to heal, or it had healed as much as it was ever going to, and that I just have to live with it. And then I learned about adhesions. So I decided to take one more crack at it. I combined mobility drills with foam rolling, and within 6 months, it was totally healed. I can now move my arm through its full range of motion without any pain, and I've been able to fully resume my training. So as I just mentioned, foam rolling or using a massage gun is key here. So is both passive and active stretching. It's a painful process and it takes a while to get through, but the end result is totally worth it. Adhesions cause restricted tissue, both in the muscle and in the surrounding myofascial tissue. Now you can feel them as knots in your muscles. You need to break these knots up, and you can do that through a process called myofascial release. You can go to a physical therapist and get a myofascial release massage, or you can do it yourself. Foam rolling, ball rolling, and using a massage gun are excellent ways to obtain myofascial release. Adhesions form spots in the muscles that are sore, and you're looking for these trigger points or knots. Start working those areas with a thumb or with your hand or an elbow, with a foam roller or a lacrosse ball or a massage gun. Do it hard enough to cause some slight pain, a moderate pain, but not too much. This is one area where more is definitely not better. Use too much pressure and you risk making it worse and re-injuring yourself. Work on the same spot for 30 to 60 seconds and do it 2 or 3 times a day. Working on your muscle adhesions can go a long way towards improving mobility, particularly if you have an injury or a painful adhesion that really limits your range of motion in a specific joint. Getting rid of adhesions can also increase your range of motion by impacting the nervous system. And I'm talking about the autonomic nervous system here. The autonomic nervous system is the one that controls your internal organs, your breathing, everything that you do without conscious thought. And it has two components, the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. The sympathetic nervous system controls, among other things, the fight or flight response. And the parasympathetic nervous system is what causes you to relax from that heightened state. Any of these types of massage activates the parasympathetic nervous system, calming and relaxing the muscles and increasing your range of motion. While the effect from massage on adhesions is permanent, the effects on the parasympathetic nervous system are temporary, only lasting about 10 to 15 minutes when used in isolation. If you want to keep that increased range of motion, then you have to follow the treatment with some other type of exercise to lock it in. And this brings us around to timing. When you perform mobility drills is just as important as what exercises you do. I usually start out with foam rolling, and then I follow that with dynamic stretching to lock in that increased range of motion. Then I do my regular exercises. When I'm finished and all my muscles, ligaments, and tendons are good and warmed up, that's when I do my passive stretching. Now, I'll be honest. As a guy who's over 70, it's taken me a while to recover my lost mobility. I started working on mobility about a year and a half ago, got distracted, and only really got back into it about 4 to 6 months ago. And I've seen a huge jump in my level of mobility. I'm not back to where I was when I was 20, but I've made a lot of progress. Now, I've never been particularly flexible, but I think with practice, I can push my flexibility way past where I was when I was young. But here's one thing I know for sure. Mobility is a lot easier to maintain than it is to recover. If I started doing mobility drills when I was in my 20s or 30s, I would definitely have been able to maintain my mobility without any loss, clear up to and beyond my present age. So it's never too early to start. And that's it for this video on mobility. If you'd like to learn more and you're new to longevity, then check out this playlist. If you're more advanced, then maybe you might want to check out this playlist on the hallmarks of aging. All right, I'm out of here. I'll catch you next time.